I don't know about you, but I pray this prayer all the time. Anoint me, Lord.
You've given us another opportunity to come before you today in prayer as we've gathered here for service. We've come to bless you. We've come to lift you. We've come to magnify your holy name. The last Sunday of this year, and we're grateful. Father, we ask you, Lord, as we gather here for praise and worship, as we gather here for praise and worship, as we gather in this sanctuary to lift up and magnify your holy name, we lift you and we praise you. We ask you, Lord God, to let your glory fill this house. Let it fill this place. We ask you, Lord God, to move right where we are. Those that are joining us from the live stream and those that are gathered in the sanctuary. Lord, we ask you that let your presence overwhelm us. We adore you and we magnify you. And we lift your holy name. We lift you up higher than our circumstances. Higher than our problems. For you are high and lifted up. You made us a promise that if we lift you up, you will draw all men unto you. Lord God, we shall lift you. Not to be seen, but we want you to be seen as we lift you. It is you that draw. And we're asking that you would meet everybody where they are this morning. As we celebrate you. on this last Sunday of 2020. It's been filled with many ups and downs, but through it all, you've been there with us, and you've never forsaken us. Oh God, we've gathered into your house, some in the sanctuary, some in their living room, no matter where they are. Lord, we ask you to receive our praise. Sanctify our hearts today. Sanctify our mouths today. And receive our praise. As we lift you and magnify you, receive our praise. Satan, we've come to make an announcement today. Out of all you've tried to do to all of us this year, we declare that we're still standing. We declare that we're still anointed. We declare that we're still saved. We declare that we're still covered. We declare that God is still good. And for the rest of our lives, we will serve the Lord. In the matchless name of Jesus, have your way in this place. In Jesus' name. Come on, everybody. I want you to put on that timeline. Amen. Amen. And amen. Listen, I'm Bishop Philip Grigsby, the senior pastor of this wonderful church. And we're so grateful to have all of you with us on this glorious Sunday morning. This is the last Sunday of 2020. And all of us have the same testimony. God's been good to us. How many of you on that timeline are not ashamed to let somebody else know that God's been good to you? Why don't you just put on that timeline right now? God has been good to me. Come on, put on that timeline. God has been good to me. Hallelujah. He's been good to me. And that's why we've gathered here. Amen. Rather it be live streaming or in person, we've gathered to magnify the name of the Lord because God has been good to us. David said, "Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good." We've tasted and we've seen and we've experienced the goodness of the Lord. Somebody put on that timeline one more time. God's been good to me. Listen, we want you to like and share. I want you to create a praise space right where you are in your home. Gather the family around the tablet or the computer, whatever you're watching this service on. And we want you to participate. We want you to lift your hands. We want you to clap your hands. We want you to sing with us. Get your Bibles ready and read with us. God's going to do something for us on today. I'm so glad that you joined us. I want you to declare right where you are that this place belongs to God. Lift your hands and declare, this place, yes, it belongs to God. This place belongs to God. This is a place of victory. This is a place of healing. This is a place where the devil has no room to abide. This place belongs to God. I want you to get ready as we get ready to go higher in God. As Elder Griggs become and lead us in the congregational song, get your mind on Jesus and let's have church. Say praise the Lord to somebody on the timeline and let's have church. God bless you.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. How many are ready to give God some praise? The last Sunday in 2020. Hallelujah. We're going to go out with a praise. Hallelujah. Yeah. that praise one more time. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What a mighty God we serve. Hallelujah. Amen. We're going to be going before the Lord at this time in our scripture reading. We're going to be coming out of Psalms 150. Once again, that is Psalms chapter 150. And we're going to read it all the way, verses 1 all the way through 6. Hallelujah. We're going to go ahead and give you some time to turn there. Hallelujah. And if you already have it, just shout Jesus. And those of you who already have it on our online service, go ahead and type in Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. I just want to thank the Lord for just giving us another week that He has blessed us in. Amen. Hallelujah. And we're getting ready to go into a whole new year. Hallelujah. That God is getting ready to do great things in our lives. Amen. Once again, that is Psalms 150, and I will be reading it in your hearing. Hallelujah. Praise ye the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in the firmament of his power. Hallelujah. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Hallelujah. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with the psaltery and harps. Praise him with the tremble and dance. Praise him with the string instruments and organs. Praise him upon the loud cymbals. Praise him upon the high sounding cymbals. Praise the everything that have breath. Praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. Give the Lord a hand praise one more time. And may God have a blessing here in the reading of his word. God bless you. Thank you.
your hands out there one more time and sing it again. Thank God for his goodness and his mercy and his loving kindness. God's been so good to us. We can all testify that we know he is the everlasting. He's the everlasting God. Today, God has given us a reason to praise his name. Beloved, I want you to know that every time you open your eyes, it serves as another reason for you to praise his name. God is worthy of our praise. He's given us total victory. For we have victory while walking on this earth. But we also have victory if we took our last breath. As the Apostle Paul says, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. I've got victory on earth. I've got victory through death. I want somebody to put on that timeline, total victory. That's what we have. We're undefeated. We're unstoppable. We have total victory. I want you to get your Bibles. Get your Bibles ready. Your Bibles ready. Great is thy faithfulness. I want you to turn to Philippians chapter 1. Yes, from the top. Philippians chapter 1. We're going to begin by reading verse number 1. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness. It's been a rough year. 2020 has been a rough year, but can I get somebody to say, great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Oh Lord, unto thee. Philippians chapter number 1. And I want to begin by reading in verse 1.
amen if you have the word of the Lord. I simply want you to type, I have the word. I have the word. We're in Philippians chapter number 1 today, and the first chapter, first verse, I should say. And we will begin reading at verse 1 through verse number 6. And the word of Allah says, Paul and Timotheus, the servants of Jesus Christ, to all the saints in Christ which are in Philippi, with the bishops and deacons, grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God upon every remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine for you all, making requests with joy for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day unto now, being confident, verse 6, being confident of this very thing, that he that hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. I want to read verse number 6 one more time. Being confident, one more time, being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. Bow your heads with me. Lord God, we thank you for your word. It is through your word that we get direction and understanding. It is through your word that we receive revelation of who you are. It is through your word that our souls are fed. It is through your word that we receive instruction on how we can be prepared to make the rapture, on how we can have victory over sin, victory over our flesh, ultimately victory over Satan himself. It is through your word that we find how to serve you, how to praise you, how to worship you, how to walk with you, how to obey you. Through your word today, Lord, we're asking that you would open up every heart, every mind and ear to hear and receive what thus said the Lord. Let your word fall on good ground. Ultimately, we pray that someone is liberated today out of the bondage of sin. We bind depression in the name of glory. We bind depression. We bind it right now. We bind fear. We bind it in the matchless name of Jesus. Let someone ask the question, what must I do to be saved? And go down in the matchless name of Jesus and be filled with the gift of the Holy Ghost. We bless you in advance for what you're going to do. In your name, Jesus. Amen and amen. God has given me a topic for today, for this last Sunday of 2020. While I was in prayer this week, God took me to this text as I prayed for a fresh word from the Lord. And the Lord directed me to Philippians chapter number 1. As I began to read this text and go in prayer to receive more revelation from the Lord in regards to what he's saying to us. God began to remind me of what type of year we have experienced. 2020 has been the year of the unexpected. Many things have taken place that we did not see coming. But I'm going to tell you, although we did not see it coming, God saw it coming. And he is the author and finisher of our faith. And that's why we have survived such a chaotic year. But our theme verse today comes out of verse number 6. Being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. It is in our text this morning, brothers and sisters, that we find the Apostle Paul writing to the church in Philippi. The Apostle Paul, he takes his time to remind the church of Philippi of the divine partnership in the gospel that believers have with one another. Paul begins his epistle with a customary greeting, with a characteristic intensity that reveals the commanding passion of Paul's life. He has a strong devotion to Christ. And the tone of this letter is set in the fact that this is a letter from a friend to his friends. Three times in the first few verses, he speaks of the name of Christ. He uses the name of Christ as a symbol of a cord that connects all of us together. I want to remind you that as Paul is in prison with Timothy and Epaphroditus and all of the other companions that were there in the prison cell with Paul, they didn't let their circumstance stop them from encouraging the faithful and joyful saints at Philippi. I want you to know that through this chaotic year, and where the world has been impacted by a global pandemic, Minister Perry, not only have we leaned on God, we've had to lean on one another. Glory be to God. And as we can see how the enemy has tried to divide the church in a time where we need one another, God has a way of keeping us together, even when the enemy tries to tear us apart. As the Apostle Paul is there in prison, he reminds the church of Philippi. This church never gave Paul any problems. He reminds them that he's still praying for them. Hallelujah. He says, I'm in shackles, I'm in bonds, but I'm still praying for you. Hallelujah. No matter what I'm going through, no matter what my circumstance looks like, it's uncomfortable right now, but I'm still praying for you. I'm in a damp dark prison cell. But I can still declare what the prophet of old declared, that the joy of the Lord is my strength. What Paul was reminding them was that though I may be Hebrew, though you may be Gentile, we have the same God. We serve the same Savior. We serve the same one that not only gives me the victory, but gives you the victory. That sounds like the church. Though we've come from different backgrounds, black, white, Hispanic, poor, rich, educated, non-educated, old and young, we serve the same God. We serve the same Savior. I'm reminded of what the Apostle Paul says in Ephesians chapter number 4 and verse number 16. It is there that the Apostle Paul pens, from him the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. Paul was reminding the church of Philippi that even though I'm in prison and you're free, we're all in this together. Can I get somebody on that timeline just to put on there? We're all in this together. I want to remind you of what the topic is again, because I want to encourage you today as I begin to extrapolate from this text. I need around 5 of you to put this on the timeline. I made it on a promise. I made it on a glory. I made it on a promise. Come on, I need around 5 of you. That's your testimony. You've been through some ups and downs this year, but you're still here. Put on that, I made it on a promise. Paul reminds the church of Philippi. He reminds them that we're all connected. God is the core. He is the one that joins us together. He brought us out of various sinful conditions. Some of you came out the nightclub. Some of you came out of being alcohol, addicted to alcohol. Some of you came out of being addicted to drugs. And some of you may have been homeless. Some of you may have been broken. But hallelujah, the same God brought us all out. Hallelujah. He brought us out by the power of his hand. But as I hasten along today, Paul, he reminds the church of Philippi of 2 important points in the first 6 verses of the first chapter. Number one, he reminds the church of Philippi that we have a privilege. Yeah, we have a privilege. That's the first point. We have a privilege. I want somebody just to put that on the timeline. A privilege. We have a privilege. And what he was reminding the church of Philippi is the privilege that we have in serving God. It's spelled out, and he gives us a clear example in the first few verses of the text. One thing that I love about the Apostle Paul, I love his writing. In his epistles, they are filled with clarity. He always asks a question, but then gives you the answer in the text. The answer is always in the word of the Lord. That's what he's reminding us of. But Paul reminds us of the privilege that we have. And he spells it out in a unique way in the first two verses. Paul reminds us that we are privileged because we are in Christ. That's where your privilege is. Your privilege comes because you are in Christ. Remember what he says in the first few verses. He mentions the name of Jesus Christ three times. We are in Christ. We are in him. Our privilege that we have is that we know that we are in him. I want to say this here. I am often troubled. I'm often troubled by those that take the opportunity of serving and knowing God for granted. I'm often troubled by those that understand that they have a privilege, but totally ignore or dismiss the fact that they have a privilege to serve God. Watch this. It's a privilege that we have to serve God. Because out of all the sin we have committed, I want you to know, first of all, you were born in sin, and nobody had to teach you how to sin. It was already in you. Remember, the Apostle Paul says, in my flesh dwelleth no good thing. I want you to know, saints of God, that out of all the sin that we have committed, a holy God, a God that knows no sin, God said, I'm still going to give you the privilege to have fellowship with me. Even though I know no sin, even though you were born in sin, I'm still going to grant you the privilege to walk with a holy God and serve me and fellowship with me. I want you to get your Bibles right now and turn with me to the book of Ephesians, if you would. Ephesians chapter number 1. Ephesians chapter number 1. I want you to meet me in the third verse. Get your Bibles, turn to Ephesians chapter 1, and meet me in the third verse. If you have the word, I want you to shout, I have the word. I hope y'all don't mind if we read a little bit today. This is not just a shouting church. We shout because the word. This is a Bible church. I want you to know the Bible will make you shout. The word of the Lord will give you a reason to praise God. Turn with me to Ephesians chapter number 1, verse number 3. And if you have it, I want you to type, I have the word. Those of you here, I want you to shout, I have the word. The word of the Lord says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Verse 4, according as he has chosen us. You need to underline that. According as he has chosen us in him. Before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. Watch this. Having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will. Verse 6, to the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us accepted in the beloved brothers and sisters, out of all the sin you have committed, I have committed, here's where we praise God. We praise God because he still gave us the privilege. Hallelujah. Out of all you and I have done wrong, out of everything we've done and said wrong, God said, I've adopted you, and I'm still going to give you the privilege to serve me. Is there anybody out there that's grateful for the privilege? Listen, I'm so glad that God is not like man, because if you violate man, man will tell you they forgive you, but they'll hold it against you secretly, and the thing they say they forgave you of, in an intense moment, they'll remind you again of what you've done. But can I tell you, when God forgives you, he throws it away in the sea of forgetfulness. He covers it under the blood, and can't no man, no woman, nor the devil himself bring it from under the blood, because it's already covered. I wish I had somebody out there that would just say, it's under the blood. I was a sinner, but it's under the blood. I was a wretch undone, but it's under the blood. I'm not here today trying to look sadiddy and trying to look pious. You better know that God brought you out of some dirty stuff. He brought you out of some stuff that not even your own mother knows about. But if it had not been for Jesus, you'd still be out there. But thank God, he still gave you the privilege to serve him. If you're grateful, I want you to type on that timeline, thank you, Lord. Somebody in here, put those hands together and shout, thank you. Hallelujah. I don't have time looking down on other people. I don't have time trying to kick people down the curb. I don't have time for that. But I do have time for is to reach down and help my brother, help my sister, pray for them, tell them what the word of the Lord says, and remind them that no matter what you're going through, all things are working together for the good of them that love God. Glory be to the Most High God. But he reminds him, I got to get back to the text before I close. He reminds him of the privilege. And the second thing he reminds them of, Minister Caldwell, he reminds them of the promise. Somebody put on that timeline, the promise. Yeah, I want somebody in here just to shout the promise. He reminds them of the promise. It is there in verse number 6. In verse number 6, where he says, being confident of this very thing. I want you to know he reminds the church of Philippi about a very important aspect of God. He tells them that he who has begun what type of work? A good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. When Paul thought of the beginning of God's work among the Philippians from the first day, it was natural that he also thought of the day when that work would be complete. I feel like running right here. God will never start something and not complete it. Everything God makes is good. When God started to work in you and I, it wasn't a bad work. Thank God, it was a good work. Hallelujah. He reminds them, saints of God, that this good work has begun. And Paul is confident that not only has it begun, but he's confident in its completion. God is a worker who completes his work. Remember in the first chapter of Genesis, when God created, he started and finished. He spoke than it was. God doesn't leave anything half done. But when you get to heaven, he's going to say, well done. I feel like running right there. Well done, my good and faithful servant. Blessed be the name of the Lord. But God, he's one that completes the work. Where we find God, we find the complete work. God is a complete God. He's total God. He doesn't have some power. He has complete power. He doesn't have some glory. He has all the glory. He doesn't deserve some of the praise. He wants all the praise, all the worship, because he's total God. What Paul was reminding the church of Philippi, he was reminding them of his confidence, yet God will complete the work. I rose to tell you today that regardless of what's going on in your life, God will complete the, somebody just put that on the timeline. He will complete it. Yes, he will. He will complete the work. And I came to tell you on today that God has been faithful to all of us. I can remember what the Apostle Paul was saying as he testified about the promise of God. I remember in his letter to his young protege by the name of Timothy. One thing I love about Paul, Paul always testified about where the Lord had brought him from. He remembered what God has done for him. How many of you out there can remember where the Lord brought you from? Yeah, you look good right now, but you ought to be glad you don't look like everything that you've been through. Nobody would fool with you if you look like what you've been through. But I'm reminded of what the Apostle Paul, what he said in 2 Timothy chapter number 3, Minister Caldwell, and verse number 11. Paul said, I'm not going to wait on anybody to call on me to testify. I'll stand up and testify right now. Paul said, persecutions, afflictions, which came unto me at Antioch, at Iconium, at Lystra, what persecutions I endured. But notice what he says at the end of 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse number 11. After everything he's endured at Antioch and Iconium and at Lystrium, Paul says, out of them all the Lord delivered me. Hallelujah. And I came to tell you that Paul was reminding them of a promise. He was reminding them, you know, the Greeks be reminding them that God is a keeper. Regardless of what we go through, God will keep me. I wish I had a witness out there that would just testify and just put on that timeline. God is a keeper. Yeah, he's a keeper. I made it this far in my life. I haven't been kept by man. It wasn't my family that kept me. If we can all keep it 100 and keep it a buck, family will let you down sometimes, but God has been there. I'm only here because I've been kept by the keeper. And not only have I been kept by the keeper, my testimony is I've been delivered by the deliverer. Hallelujah. He's a strong deliverer. I've been delivered. That's the promise we have. God will deliver us no matter what we go through in life, he will deliver us. I wish I had somebody out there that would just testify and say, God will, he will deliver me. I'm standing on the promise. 2020 has been a rough year. It's been filled with many turns. We've been upside down at times. We've been blindsided by things. But one thing we can all say is that the Lord has kept us and he has protected us. I wish I had somebody out there that would just put on that timeline. I've been kept by the keeper. He made us a promise in his word that he would never leave us nor forsake us. And I came to tell you that in the beginning of this year, we said it was going to be 2020 and have 2020 vision. Some people thought that meant something tied to prosperity, but I came to tell you what God was trying to tell us, was that this would be the year that we be able to see clearly who's who in our lives. God exposed the people that were not supposed to be in your life. There were some people that were in your life because it benefited them, and after they saw that they couldn't get anything out of you, they forsook you. God had to show you to stop putting your trust in people and to put your trust in the Lord. Do I have a witness out there that understands what I'm talking about? God showed you in the midst of this pandemic that you cannot rely on coming to the building anymore. Some people, come on here, some people were only building minded, but God said, I'm not looking for the people that are building minded. I'm looking for the people that are Jesus minded and are mission minded, and they'll stay connected when the church doors are closed. They'll stay connected when there's no more services, no more announcements, but they'll go in their living room, get down on their knees and say, come by here, come by here, dear Lord, come by here, oh Lord, come by here. I came to tell you that in this year, God gave you clarity of something else that you needed to understand. He gave us clarity that in times of uncertainty, we have an anchor. We have somebody we can depend on. I wish I had a witness out there. You tried to depend on your job, but the pandemic took that away. You tried to depend on watching sports for a good minute. The pandemic took that away. Some people out there tried to depend on man giving them hope, but God, he took that away. What did the Lord show you? God showed us that in times like these, we need a Savior. He showed us that he is all we need. And what the Lord did in this year is he caused the church to turn back to the lover of its soul. He caused the church to turn back to the Redeemer that pointed out, he calls the church to look to the hills, from its cometh our help. All of our help. I rose to tell you, he had to remind you that all of your help, all of my help, comes from him. Can't nobody do us like Jesus. He had to show us in this year, you don't need the doors open for me to save anybody. I can save people in their homes. He said, I gotta show you, I don't need you. I am all the church needs. I'm the establisher, I'm the founder, I'm the rock, I'm the lily in the valley, I'm the bright and morning star, I am the great I am, I'm the everlasting Father, I am the one you need, I'll be with you in the fire, I'll be with you through the storm, I'll be with you through the rain. Is there anybody? Ooh, is there anybody out there today that can lift your hands and say, I made it on a promise. It wasn't my money that brought me through the year, but I made it on a promise. It wasn't my family that brought me through the year, but I made it on a promise. It wasn't the church that brought me through the year. I couldn't get in here, but I made it on a promise. What did he promise us? He promised us that the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous, we run in it, and we are saved. What did he promise us? He promised us, no matter what it is, no matter the weapon, no weapon, this year, next year, last year, shall be able to prosper. What did he promise? He promised to give power to the faint, and to them that have no might, he'll increase their strength. What did he promise? He promised to be the good shepherd, and we will know his voice in a time where there's so many false prophets, so many false teachers. God said, my sheep will know my voice. What did he promise? He promised that he'll be there when no one else is. What did he promise? He promised that he'll take us through the fire, but he'll bring us out as pure gold. What did he promise? He promised that he'll never lie, he'll never leave us, he'll never let us down. What did he promise? He promised to hold us if we dwell in the secret place of the Most High God. Under the shadow of his almighty hand, beneath his wings of faithfulness, beneath his wings of healing, he told us we'd have the victory. What else has he promised us? He promised if we hold on, if we hold out one day, he's coming back. I still believe in the rapture. I still believe he's coming back. I still believe any day now, any moment, he can crack the sky and we will be like him. He made us a promise that one day the trumpet will sound. The dead in Christ shall rise, and we who are alive and remain shall be caught up to meet him in the air. Glory. He made us a promise. I'm living on a promise. I need around five of you just to put on that timeline. I made it on a promise. I made it on a promise. Not man's promise. It's God's promise. I made it. I'm living on a promise. I got to get out of here. I got to close now. But is there anybody? Is there anybody out there that can testify that during this year, when everything was going on, you didn't know what was happening, and you asked the question, Lord, what's going on? And the Lord reminded you of his word, and you're here today. Out of all that you've been through, you may have been afflicted, you've been under attack, you've been walked over, you've been talked about, you've been misunderstood, you've been laughed at, you've been mocked. Yeah, you cried yourself to sleep, but you made it, and you found out that weeping may endure for the night, but joy, come in the morning, joy, I still got joy. I still got a praise. I still have my hope. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but only lean on Jesus' name. On Christ, the solid rock I stand. Oh! All other ground. All other ground. All other ground. Sinking sand. I made it. I made it on a promise. Somebody put that on the timeline one more time. I made it. I made it on a promise. Out of everything that we've gone through, Minister Caldwell, our testimony is that we made it on the promise. Lift your hands right now, everybody. I want you to take 15 seconds to worship him right now. Lift your hands where you are. Come on, everybody. It's been a rough year. It's been a rough year. F sharp. But we made it. We made it. And now we can say that he deserves our hallelujah. He deserves our worship. Those of you that need prayer, I want you to, if you're not ashamed, on that timeline, just put what it is you need God to do. How can we pray for you today? We're going to pray. We're going to pray. And we're going to believe God. We're going to believe God to have his way in your life. Lift your hands where you are. Simple song says, my hallelujah.
Yeah.
for you right now. I'm gonna pray for you right now. Some of you, under the sound of my voice, are suffering right now. As I pray for you, I want you to extend your hands toward the screen. As a point of contact, I dare you to touch the screen as a point of contact. And as I pray for you, the Spirit of a living God, the power of God, shall arrest you right where you are. He called out our Messiah. Glory. Hiya. Glory. I feel a breakthrough. I feel healing. I feel healing in my spirit. I feel healing in my spirit today. Step forth your hand. That's what the Lord told the man with the withered hand. Stretch forth your hand. Hiya. Stretch out. Let's pray. Father, in the name of the Most High God, Jesus Christ, I come today declaring healing over those that are afflicted. For she are told us, Aya, Aya, heal right from the crown of their head to the sole of their feet. For she are, Aya, heal right now. For she are. Let the power of the Holy Ghost begin to burn out diabetes. Let it burn out all sicknesses, all manner of disease. We call out COVID-19. We call out cancer. We call it out in the name of Jesus. We healed. Your hand. Bishop, I've been going through. I just need a little bit of strength. I need a little bit of strength. If I'm talking to you, break it down. If I'm talking to you, I just want you to put on a timeline. This is for me today. This is for me. This is for me. This is for me. This is for me. Those of you out there that have been struggling, it seems like the enemy has been trying to attack you. It seems like you come out of one trial only to go into another. Stretch forth your hands right now. Strength. Oh, hallelujah. I feel strength in here. Father, in your name. Glory. Glory. Father, equal Tadabashia. Father, in your name. You said you have not given us the spirit of fear. You have not given us the spirit of fear, but the power of love and of a sound mind. Father, I declare and decree what the word of the Lord says. For he, being confident that he that hath begun a good work in us, shall perform it for the day of Jesus Christ, to the day that you practice God, for the day that you come back from the church. And I release strength right now. Be made whole. No. Message us. You need to let us know that you're ready to be baptized. We have a pool here. Listen, you don't want to miss the rapture. Hell is a real place. Oh, I hear you. I hear the late Bishop Iona Locke saying, hell is a real place. I don't want to go. You don't want to go. You need to be saved the Bible way. Not man's way. Man's way is easy. God has a formula he's already given us. You need to be baptized in Jesus. You need to message us and say, I want to be baptized in the name of the man that hung on the cross. I want to be baptized in the name of the man that died and rose for sin. I want to be baptized in the name that's above every name. And you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Our giving information is on the screen. Those of you that want to give, we have multiple ways that you can do that. But we want to wish you all a wonderful, happy holiday season. As we close out this year in 2020, I want to leave you with this. It's not how you start, it's how you finish. I made it on the promise. Join us for watch night service. More information will come with details. But we'll see you later on this week as we cross over into 2021. God bless you. I'm Bishop G. We'll see you next time. You deserve it. Oh, you deserve it.